All right, we'll get started now. Katie, if you could start the recording. I want to first welcome all the attendees, but before I begin the workshop presentation, I want to pass it over to Viviana Marzano, who will give instructions on Spanish interpretation.
Good evening. In order to provide language access, we will be offering interpretation between English and Spanish. If you are bilingual English and Spanish, you don't need to click anything. If you are not bilingual English and Spanish, once the interpretation feature is activated, you will see a globe in the bottom right-hand side of the screen if you are calling from a computer. Do click on the globe, do click on English. If you are calling from a tablet or a phone, you will see the three-dot menu. Do click on the dot, do click on interpretation, do click on English, and click on done. Buenas noches. Para ofrecer acceso lingüístico esta noche, vamos a estar ofreciendo interpretación al español y al inglés. Si usted es bilingüe, no necesita hacer clic en ningún lado. Si usted no es bilingüe, cuando se active la interpretación y está llamando de una computadora, cuando vea el icono del globo, haga clic en el globo, haga clic en interpretación y haga clic en español. Si usted está llamando de una tableta o por teléfono, va a haber un menú de tres puntos, haga clic en los tres puntos, haga clic en interpretación, haga clic en Spanish y clic en Done. Thank you, gracias. Katie, you can enable me as an interpreter, please. So now I'm going to go into the interpretation channel. Ahora voy a ir al canal de interpretación. Thank you.
Thank you, Viviana. Can everyone hear me? Can I get everyone hear my audio? All right, yes. So the agenda for tonight, this is a little different for us as we are doing a virtual workshop, at least in advanced planning, this is a first for us. What we'll do is give a couple of further instructions on some of the Zoom features that we'll be using, and then introduce the project team and staff that are on hand tonight, give an update since the last workshop, which is back in February, on what we've been doing for this project since then. And then we'll go over the draft CWMP that we released in October, talk about the next steps in the adoption process, and then have a Q&A session and finish with some closing comments. So in Zoom, for those who haven't used these features before, you'll see a bar on your screen that has the following features. Just want to highlight the Q&A and raise hand features. So as we've already started, I'll be giving a presentation, but during the presentation, you can submit questions and one of the team members may be able to answer the question as we go along. We'll hold off on fielding questions during the presentation, other than submitting written responses. At the end, we'll summarize those questions and any that have been answered and address any further questions. And then we'll also use the raise the hand feature where you can audibly ask any questions or provide any comments you would like. The Q&A and the raise your hand tools are two of the tools we'll be utilizing on Zoom tonight. So we have several members of the project team and other city staff here tonight. So I just want to quickly mention those folks. My name is Andy Newkirk. I guess I haven't introduced myself yet. I'm a senior planner in advanced planning at the city, and I am the project manager for the CWMP. We also have Ann Wells here from advanced planning. She's the advanced planning manager. We have Pam Ritchie, who's a contract planner with the city. She's with RM Design Group. She's been helping kind of steer this project from the start, and her and her team are providing invaluable support on the IT side tonight. We also have two staff members that at least at our last workshop weren't staff members. I believe George attended, but not as a member of city staff at that time. George is the park and open space, parks and open space manager. So he oversees the city's properties, open spaces, and he has a lot of experience with creeks. So he's a great resource that we have on the team now at the city, as is Melissa Nelson, who's the environmental services coordinator. One of her many duties is overseeing the stormwater management program and stormwater and how we deal with rainwater are really important to creeks. And so both of those staff members in Public Works have been really helpful in working through some of the implementation programs that we'll be talking about later. You've already met Viviana, who's providing interpretation services tonight. We also have DUDEC team members here with us. John Davis is the project manager for DUDEC, and he's an ecologist at DUDEC. And Melissa Blundell, who's the deputy PM, project manager for the project, and she's a biologist. We also have Ann Center with Balance Hydrologics. Balance Hydrologics is a sub-consultant to DUDEC and focused on geomorphology elements within the CWMP. So you may hear from various team members during the Q&A session later. I'll be leading the presentation that we'll start with. So with that, if you've attended a workshop with us on this project before, this slide will look familiar. The general plan calls for a creek and watershed management plan. That's been in the general plan since 06. And really, it's a really important document because we don't have anything right now at the city, no adopted document that really consolidates the information about our creeks and provides any guidance on what to do with our creeks. There's information in various locations, but we don't have a central document that focuses on our creeks. So this is a really exciting time for us to do this project and provide that information. So the CWMP provides information about the physical creek characteristics. We'll talk about that in some detail. And then identifies places where impairments are located and provides best management practices and potentially future projects to address those impairments that have been identified. So what have we been up to since February? At our last workshop, we mentioned that we were going to take a contract amendment to council to do further field work, and council approved that contract amendment. So since then, DUDEC has conducted riparian bird surveys on all city creeks and also conducted a wildlife corridor study. Wildlife corridor study included traversing the creeks, identifying things like animal tracks, but also installing motion sensor cameras in all of the creeks to identify nocturnal movement, primarily. We've been working on writing the CWMP as we've released that document, and there's internal review as well as the technical advisory committee conducted a review of the document. The technical advisory committee includes members of different agencies at the state, federal, and local level, as well as representatives from different non-governmental organizations that are of particular interest in creeks and watershed issues. And so that review was invaluable to us, and we spent quite a bit of time fielding their comments and trying to incorporate their concerns and their edits into our document before we released it. So we've had that review and back and forth. We also provided council with an update on September 1st. So anyone interested in hearing more information can review that presentation that's posted on the project website, although much of that material is covered, will be covered here tonight. And then as I mentioned, we released the CWMP that was on October 20th, so it's been out for about 2 weeks. If you haven't accessed the document, there's a city website specifically dedicated to the CWMP. If you received an email or saw a press release about this workshop, they will have a link to the project website, and the document is broken up into a couple pieces but available on that page at the top of the page. So if you haven't already, that's where you'll find the document to review. So we won't spend too much time here going over the studies, but I did want to show a couple pictures because they're just too cool not to. So to give you a little flavor of what you will see in those studies, which are provided as appendices to the CWMP, here's a coyote and striped skunk at a standoff at Winchester and Elwin Canyons in the northwestern corner of the city. We had a black bear sighting on Los Carneros, although did not want to pose for the camera. And we had a mountain lion on San Pedro, which is a really exciting image to capture. So these are just a few of the snapshots from those cameras that we installed for this study. Further pictures and summary of the wildlife that was identified is included in the CWMP as an appendix. So getting into the document itself, that's really what we're here to present to the public and provide some kind of some context and a little bit of a guide, as the document's really long and there's a lot of information to absorb. So there's 8 sections in the document and then several appendices, and we'll go over most of these sections in the subsequent slides, but this just gives a snapshot of the general outline of the document itself. So section 1 just provides kind of that basic context for the plan, why we're doing it, and a little bit of the geographic situation, although really maps tell the story of our creeks and the broader context of the creek system. As you can see, the city of Goleta is kind of long and narrow, or short or squat, and a lot of the creeks run north-south, so they start up above the city, go through the city, and then typically drain outside the city. Only 2 city creeks, Tecolote and Bell Canyon, actually drain out to the Pacific within the city boundaries, and only 1 creek, Devereaux, originates within the city. And so the typical pattern is for the creeks to start well above the city, go through the city briefly, and then out through the city. And you'll see 6 of the creeks actually drain into Goleta Slough. So Goleta Slough has a kind of a, is a big drainage area for the city. And I'll also note that we use naming conventions for these creeks. Sometimes different people refer to different creeks by different names. An example would be El Encanto. Some people consider that part of the Devereaux Creek system. Some people might refer to it as Phelps Ditch. In this plan, it's El Encanto, and that's to reflect the naming conventions that you see in the general plan. So rather, that may create some naming convention conflict with some other document, but we align the creek names with those that are used in the city of Goleta's general plan. To provide that kind of broader picture, here is a map of the watersheds that drain through the city's creeks. And you can see the city of Goleta is down there at the bottom, and the watersheds are much larger, and often they go all the way up to Camino Cielo. So they originate in the National Forest and then traverse unincorporated Santa Barbara County, then enter the city, and then often drain outside the city. So that again provides that context, and we'll discuss this a little more later, but one of the things we've heard throughout the CWMP process is the need for multi-jurisdictional coordination, and this map kind of illustrates why that's important. Is really, it's just a small segment of many of these creeks that actually go through the city proper. So section 2 just provides a summary of outreach. I won't spend too much time here. There's also a summary, Appendix A to the CWMP provides the survey results, but we covered that at the second workshop, so we're not going to go through that in any detail tonight. But if you're interested and haven't seen that summary, that's provided in Appendix A. Section 3 starts to get a little more lengthy, and it's the policy and regulatory background. And what this section does is consolidates all the different regulatory authorities and rules and plans and policies that are relevant to Goleta's creeks and watersheds. So we start with state and federal law like Endangered Species Act or the California Environmental Quality Act or the California Coastal Act, various laws and regulations that would be applicable to any kind of projects within city creeks. We also summarize other agencies with oversight or regulatory authority. So that's other agencies that may have permitting jurisdiction over projects within creeks, like Army Corps of Engineers, for instance. Then we also list kind of the variety of city regulations and plans that are applicable to city creeks. So we start as we tend to do with planning, with the general plan, in particular, there's a lot of policies in the conservation element and the safety element that are particularly relevant to city creeks. And we summarize those and actually include the text of those policies. We also reference the Goleta Municipal Code regulations that are relevant. These include zoning regulations, which were adopted earlier this year, but also stormwater regulations and floodplain regulations that are applicable to projects within and adjacent to creeks. We also list various master management plans that the city has adopted. And this provides kind of the broader picture of all the different plans that are relevant. So these are things like the bike and pedestrian master plan, which includes trails along city creeks, the butterfly habitat management plan, which includes some management actions that impact Devereaux Creek, the homelessness strategic plan, which is in process right now, which will hopefully improve the situation along creeks as it relates to homelessness encampments. So there's a variety. That's not the full list, but there's several plans that are relevant that are explained there. We also note the Lake Los Carneros management plan. The CWMP doesn't focus much on that area because there is a separate management plan for Lake Los Carneros. We also list out existing planned capital projects that can have beneficial impacts to creeks. So these are projects that specifically address things like flooding and trash that can get into the creek system, but also other projects more transportation related that may include restoration work along city creeks so that their implementation will benefit the creeks themselves. We also list CEQA thresholds. So that's when we're doing an environmental analysis of projects, the things we look at that could benefit kind of the biology and the water quality and groundwater that could impact the creeks themselves. And then we also briefly describe other activities within the city, such as flood control activities, Goleta Water District activities, and summarize the Goleta Water District's safe ordinance and groundwater management plan. So there's a lot of information in Section 3, and it's really intended to try to provide a comprehensive summary of all the different moving parts that are relevant outside the CWMP to city creeks and watersheds. So Section 4 really gets into what I described earlier about the need for good information about and consolidated information about our creeks. So the section starts with kind of the overview of the system with hydrology and water quality, channel geomorphology, and biological resources. And then there's a separate section that goes into some detail about each individual creek. And so that's where you see a lot of the data from, or a lot of a summary of all the field work that was done, as well as other analysis of existing data from reports and from previous water quality sampling and GIS data. So really a summary of a lot of different data sources that we hope will provide a really nice baseline of our creeks that we can track over time. So what does some of that data look like? These are just a couple snapshots from Section 4. Here is a table, table 2 of the CWMP, that shows a summary of the area of each watershed based on jurisdiction. And this kind of provides a tabular illustration of those maps we saw earlier in the presentation, where a lot of the area within these creeks are outside city jurisdiction. So this just provides a calculation of what we see in the maps. We also have maps and summary of hydrology and water quality. So the list of beneficial uses by creek, as well as the known impairments based on historical water quality sampling. So we see that summarized for the city as a whole, and then each individual creek also has that information provided. We also have things like tables like table 4, which gives kind of a generalized channel geomorphology for each creek based on some different segments that were surveyed. And this was kind of a summary of work that was done in the fall of last year. So this is just a little snippet of that table. It's quite a long table, but it gives kind of that kind of general summary of the creek geomorphological conditions. For biological resources, there's quite a bit of information. There's a summary of the different vegetative communities that were surveyed within 400 feet of the creeks, the creek center lines, and then also the acreage within each creek corridor that is associated with those vegetative communities. So again, a nice baseline that we can compare to in the future. There's also tables that summarize known occurrences of special status plant and wildlife species as well. And then, as mentioned earlier, there's individual creek information. Each creek has its own subsection that starts with the quick facts, which is a nice little summary of different characteristics of the creek. And then there's also text summaries that follow these quick fact tables. There's all included in those in the individual creek information are things like the wildlife observed. And then each creek also has its own map. I believe these are figures 7A through I. And they list out, they map those vegetative communities as well as known locations of invasive plant species and other feature biological features of those creeks. So a lot of information is provided in section 4. Section 5 builds off of section 4 and summarizes the impairments identified through the work. These include hydrology and water quality, where we start with stream flow as a potential impairment. That's something we heard at earlier workshops and from our TAC members. And it's something that we have an implementation program for as well. And then also water quality objective exceedances based on water quality sampling that's been done over the last few decades. There's also impairments based on channel geomorphology and biological resources, and show you kind of tables of what that looks like, as well as potential impacts from flood control activities. And then also impairments, potential future impairments based on climate change or the exacerbation of impairments based on climate change. And then also impairments to the humans as a result of the creeks themselves. And those last two bullets are things we heard from our technical advisory committee that they wanted us to flag. And so we included those based on the earlier feedback we've received. So for water quality, geomorphology, and biological impairments, there's a table that for each one of those that shows each creek and then the impairments that were observed for those creeks based on that impairment category. So here's a table of the biological impairments. You see the columns represent the different biological resource impairments, and then the rows show which creeks exhibit those impairments. And so this provides kind of a summary, and then each one of those impairments is described in some detail after the table. And so you'll see three different tables in section 5 like this, one for water quality, one for geomorphology, and one for biology. So section 6 is really where the rubber meets the road. And when we talk about a management plan, really where that management kicks in. There's 15 implementation programs in section 6. Each has a stated goal and one or more strategies to seek out that goal. And then a set of actions that aim to achieve the goal over time. There's quite a few actions. Our rough count is there's 188 actions listed in section 6, which sounds kind of overwhelming, but some of them are just to continue doing the things we already do, and then some are in fact new actions that we'll have to implement over time. And it's important to understand that because of this, the implementation program represents an aspirational set of actions. There's no specific staff member at this point dedicated solely to CWMP implementation. There is no dedicated funding at this point for the future actions. So it's really over time, the actions will need to be reviewed and priorities considered given the limited resources available, especially in the short term with COVID and uncertainty of the financial situation moving forward. The reality is it may take time to implement the implementation program. But what I want to do is just kind of briefly go over the 15 programs. I would suggest anyone interested to actually look at Section 6. It's hard to summarize this all, but because the implementation programs are so important to the CWMP, I wanted to just quickly go over each one of them. So program one is plan management. So this outlines the responsibility for management of the CWMP, and this will fall within the Public Works Department. There's also a schedule of CWMP implementation status updates before City Council. So the idea here is periodically every 2 years, staff will present an update on the CWMP, and that can inform future implementation in terms of resourcing, resource funding, and staff fund allocation to do the CWMP implementation. Program one also identifies the need for staffing and funding so that as we move forward, the resources will be available based on the desire to see certain implementation actions seen through. Program two is funding. So I'm sounding a bit repetitive at this point, but it's really important that we consider funding moving forward, including outside sources of funding and also potentially internal sources and ideally permanent sources of funding for CWMP implementation. But that with the constraints right now, that may be difficult in the short term. And program three looks at data management and information gathering. We spend a lot of time gathering data and consolidating information. However, that, no pun intended, that's fluid. The data is fluid and things will change over time. And so it's important that we do things like annual creek surveys, we maintain good data, aerial data, things like that. We also look at our water quality analysis. Should we be sampling more? Should we be sampling in different locations? How do we improve that over time? And then also look at things like flow, where we don't have very good data on changes in flow over time on most of our creeks. So how do we do that over time to get better information? Program four looks at plan updates. So as things change over time, we may need to update the plan. And so there's a planning horizon here and an update every 5 to 10 years based on council direction, but that we want to update the plan with new information, new lessons learned. One thing that we may want to do, provide more information on or updated information are things like climate change as we better understand climate change impacts on our creek system. Program five, based on the feedback we've heard throughout this project, is a really critical one, and that's interagency and nonprofit organization coordination. So this is kind of building off some of the relationships we've built with the TAC and some of the relationships we've already developed to work with other jurisdictions, with other agencies on multi-jurisdictional collaboration and to leverage nonprofit organizations and their interest and engagement moving forward. So those will be really critical elements to CWMP implementation moving forward. Program six is something we'd already be doing, but it's calls for planning consistency, and that's making sure that various city plans complement each other and work together, and that we're not doing something with the CWMP that is in conflict with our parks and playgrounds plan, or vice versa, that we're making sure we're doing everything kind of comprehensively throughout our different documents. Program seven is our public education and engagement. And that's really building off of a lot of the work in our stormwater program. There's already quite a bit of engagement that goes on. Some people may not be aware of all of it. So we've highlighted existing actions that we will continue, but also flagged areas where we can improve, and that there's certain things like information we provide on our website and at the planning counter, and using our social media resources to provide further information. Also information through a sign program for our creeks, continuous marking of our storm drains. And then the CWMP also in this program identifies the need for an advisory structure to City Council for CWMP implementation. It doesn't specifically call out exactly what that structure will look like. We'll mention that in a future slide here, but calls out the need for an advisory system to help prioritize implementation over time. And then program eight calls for the review and regulation of development. So this is existing practice. We already do this, where we look at development and consistency with the general plan, with zoning regulations and stormwater regulations. However, we thought it was important to include this program because it's really critical that we ensure that new development does not create new problems. A lot of these programs seek to remedy the existing impairments. However, at the same time, we don't want to be creating new problems as we move along. So program nine identifies land purchases and conservation easements. So these are ways to more proactively leverage the existing land adjacent to creeks for things like restoration projects where land purchases may make sense. There are some challenges. Some of the undeveloped parcels along city creeks are identified for housing. So there's that tension that we would have to deal with. And so there may be opportunities where conservation easements may make more sense, depending on the specific location within the city. However, we do call out as a potential future land purchase, Bishop Ranch. It's one of the only parcels, if not the only parcel in the city that has two creeks traversing it. So we do call out that parcel in particular. Program 10 looks at invasive plant removal. As I mentioned earlier, we map locations where there's significant invasive plants like Arundo. However, there are also other invasives throughout the creek system in the city. And looking at programs and trying to find ways to have successful invasive plant removal, particularly targeting city-owned properties, is an easier way to address invasives and without having to get landowner consent, as we would consent to our own projects, of course. And we'll also want to map and track invasive plants over time, because that can change and there can be new areas of invasives over time. Program 11 looks at riparian tree and vegetation planning and protection. And so that again targets city-owned property for potential tree plantings. We also identify the need to ensure that any plantings, especially in city-owned property, are appropriate for riparian corridors. So we identify certain types of trees that should be appropriate. And then also considers a private property tree planting program similar to the city of Santa Barbara. The Creeks Division there has a program where they help fund the tree plantings on private property. So that's another option that we could look at in the future to move beyond just the city open spaces to increase the riparian plantings. Program 13 looks at flooding and drainage. So that calls out specific, I skipped program 12, and that's a really important one. So program 12 is creek restoration and enhancement projects. So that's looking at some of the bigger projects that may occur in the long term. There's existing capital improvement projects that are listed, but there's also the potential to develop capital improvement projects for things like removal of fence revetment and concrete channels and nick points and fish passage impediments. So these are some of the big in creek projects that may take a really long time and will have a lot of constraints, including private property ownership, as the city doesn't own all the creek corridors. That some people may assume that, but sometimes the creeks traverse city property, sometimes they traverse private property. So there can be a lot of challenges to doing these types of capital projects, but we felt like it was important to identify those projects, and over time those CIPs can be developed and analyzed and those projects can get developed. So that program 12 is really kind of looking at some of those bigger projects that hopefully can get implemented over the long term. Program 13 is flooding and drainage, and that lists out existing capital projects to address flooding issues, as well as specifies the need to really coordinate closely with county flood control with their work that they do in the city and tracking that work over time. And then also looking at potential future climate change impacts. So supporting future studies that look at kind of the merging of rain events with sea level rise and coastal inundation and what that might mean for creeks in the future. So getting better information on those, the impacts of climate change on flooding. Program 14 looks at water quality. So that flags the continuation of our work with stormwater regulations and with monitoring, as well as implementation of the Track 2 trash amendments to our stormwater permit. And then also looking at future hydro modification impacts and supporting of kind of green infrastructure projects, whether they be pilot projects from the city on city-owned property or through private public partnerships. And then also flags the homelessness strategic plan as an important element to improve water quality. The CWMP acknowledges the potential impacts of human disturbance on the biological quality of city creeks, but defers to the homelessness strategic plan on addressing those homelessness encampments and those impacts, because the homelessness strategic plan really takes that holistic view of the issue of homelessness, and rather than try to kind of step on the toes of that project, we think that the creeks will enjoy co-benefits from the implementation of the homelessness strategic plan. So finally, the last program is protection of base flows. And this is something we heard from the public and TAG members is concerns about reductions in flows in the city creeks. And so this program will look at ways we can better analyze that over time and flags different actions to take when we identify flow impairments and kind of how we could go about improving that. Even it's quite possible that any future base flow impairments will need kind of a multi-jurisdictional collaboration to address, as many of those, the causes may be from outside of the city. So that's kind of a summary of the programs. Tried to highlight some of the key items there, but I certainly suggest you look at Section 6 if you're interested in these programs and what all is included. So finally, very quickly on the appendices, there's several here. The public outreach responses, as mentioned, just kind of summarizes what we heard from the public through the process. Appendix B looks at plans and projects outside the city, so some example projects that we may be able to try to model within the city. Appendix C looks at conservation element policy CE 2.2, that's our streamside protection area policy, and looks at how that's changed over time and some examples of wind reductions and the buffers have been approved. Appendix D goes into beneficial uses, water quality, and pollutant definitions. So that's just to provide a guide for when water quality issues are discussed through the CWMP, as there's a lot of very specific nomenclature for that topic area. Appendices E and F are the reports that resulted from the wildlife corridor study and riparian bird study. So if you're interested in what we learned from those, from that field work, I would suggest looking at those reports. And then G provides kind of a summary of all the planned wildlife species documented through the project. Appendix A lists potential impairments outside the city of Goleta. So we really focused on the city of Goleta and issues within the city of Goleta. However, we fully acknowledge that there's a lot of issues outside the city that can impact creeks within the city. And so this is a summary of impairments that were flagged by the Environmental Defense Center. And we can use them as discussion points for when we have kind of more multi-jurisdictional work on our creeks and watersheds. Appendix I are the project description sheets. So these really align with some of the actions in Program 12, which are those habitat restoration and enhancement projects. And these kind of outline in kind of general terms what some of those capital projects might entail. So those are some of those bigger projects like removing channel ice creeks, for instance. And then Appendix J lists potential funding sources. So this is a starting point for where we may look for funding to implement the CWMP. And there's an action to update this table periodically to make sure we kind of are tracking potential funding sources. And then Appendix K just provides a kind of example of some of the mailings we might do in the outreach program. I think it's Program 7. One of the things we'll look to do moving forward is direct mailing to properties adjacent to creeks to provide info on what you should and shouldn't do on your property, especially, you know, adjacent to the creek corridor itself. And so that's just an example. It's what to plant and what not to plant. So, you know, to try to kind of give people some tools to improve the creek corridors. So that's the summary of the CWMP as it's been released. In terms of next steps, we plan to go to council for adoption on the 17th. So that staff report will be released pretty soon. It will be introduced as it's been released. So the recommendation will include the plan that is posted on the city website. After adoption, we'll need to consider funding and staffing. Those are the kind of two really critical things. One of the benefits of getting through the adoption process in the short term is we can then utilize the CWMP for work program and budgeting, which will actually start at the end of the month. So that'll be a really valuable resource when we think about the allocation of resources. As I mentioned, we'll need to identify the advisory structure for implementation. So how exactly that will look, we'll need to think about that and prioritize implementation actions. And that's kind of twofold, both prioritizing implementation actions against each other, but also in terms of the other priorities within the city. So that's where that work plan and budgeting will be really important. So those are those next steps. With that, that's the presentation at this point. Pam, I'll kick it off to you to summarize any of the answered questions, and then we can go through the written questions. And then once we do that, we'll open it up to folks raising their hands, and they can we'll unmute you, and you can provide you can ask questions or provide any comments you would like. So Pam, if you could go over the answered questions briefly, and then we can touch on the other questions.
Sure. Hey everybody, my name's Pam Ritchie, and I'm a contract planner that's been part of the CWMP team. And so I was going to serve as host for the question and answer period. And we received a handful of questions that are still unanswered from Paul. So I'd read those into the record for the benefit of everyone else who's listening. And then we can go to the other participants and ask for additional questions, and we'll ask you to raise your hand, and then I'll call on you individually, and team members will respond to your questions accordingly. So the first question from Paul that we received is, do you think there could be a wildlife bridge over one of the major arteries? Cathedral Oaks Road would be a good road for this. And he goes on to say that he likes the creeks to preserve wildlife. He's noticed that there's been a decline in the skunk population recently. So I thought maybe someone from the city of Goleta might be able to answer that question about any plans for a wildlife bridge over any of the arteries.
Yeah, I can field that one. There isn't at this time. I mean, that's even probably beyond what we've considered in the CWMP. I think there's so many other things to consider that that would have to be much further down the road in reality. That's a really complicated, and I think one of the things to also think about is not only the cost of building it, the construction of it, but also the lack of undeveloped land kind of below and above the road would prove a real challenge. So it's not something we've looked at, certainly not with the CWMP at this point. I think we have some more basic management actions that we need to kind of focus on at this point. But it's something we could maybe look well down the road, but I think it would be really, you know, really challenging. And in terms of wildlife movement, you know, one thing that can we, which is more kind of on point, I think, for the CWMP is looking at, you know, making sure we have we adhere to our policies when we're looking at, you know, culvert design and supporting wildlife movement through as we consider capital projects and development, so that they can utilize the creek corridors themselves for movement. And we certainly saw with the wildlife study that wildlife do use the creek corridors to move, particularly at night. That they do serve that function. We want to be thinking about that as we move forward.
So the next question from Paul was about how much water is removed from the creeks by agriculture and ranches. Go ahead.
Yeah, and this is something we've certainly heard concerns about. And so kind of a first step is looking at those base flows and looking at how they change over time. And to get that, you need data. There's a few USGS gauges on city creeks, although it's pretty limited. And so, you know, that would be a first step is really understanding how that changes over time. And then there are certain actions, and that's program 15, that we'll look at, like, okay, what are those next steps? And some of those things would include looking at potentially kind of those diversions and water rights issues for the agricultural operations north of the city. So we did flag that. There is information about water rights in a state database, although those are rights that property owners have. Those aren't like illegal diversions or anything, but they're also, you know, potential to dedicate for in-stream flows through those water rights as well. So things to consider down the road. A first step would be kind of better understanding the changes over time and tracking that information.
Thanks, Andy. Next question from Paul is, he remembers a suspension bridge on Los Caneros Creek Canyon near a waterfall. And his question, is that bridge still existing? And do you know when and why it was constructed?
I do not know. I don't know if any of the other panelists are aware of that history, but I am not sure. So if anyone wants to speak up, otherwise we'd have to look into that.
Okay, well, maybe one of the other members of the audience might have some insight in that when we hear from them. Should I move to the next Paul question?
Sure.
Okay. Will publicity coming from release of the CWMP to the public affect the election for city council candidates?
Yeah, I mean, it's certainly not something we considered, but we think that this is all just, you know, good practice and represents the data that we found. So I don't think this will constitute an October surprise.
And let me add to that, Andy, that or Paul, really, that it's a you know, I could see why you would ask the question given the timing. I think we just kind of arrived here on the timing, but as it turns out, it's really good timing for a release of the Creek and Watershed Management Plan, because this is the time of year, like, forget the election, but this is the time of year that we get ready to do budgeting for the next fiscal year. And we start with our work plan. So when we have new new projects or new products that we have to integrate into our strategic plan and our work programs that build into our budget. This is exactly the time of year where the timing is right to get the new possible projects for our capital improvement programs to get considered by council for work in the upcoming fiscal year. So that's the benefit of this timing. It doesn't have anything to do with an election, but I could see why you would ask that question from a timing perspective.
And so Paul's last question that I have, it kind of segues from the last one. From what he's reviewed in the report, finds it a balanced scientific report. And he asks the panelists if the CWMP will be taken seriously by future city council members. And I think the answer to that is, I think it certainly will. And I'll let the city staff provide more feedback on that. Who will inform future members of the findings and data in the CWMP? And will advocates working on the team provide findings and data? And what happens next? I think Andy described the next step would be going to the City Council on November 17th. But I'll let the city staff talk about the importance of this document to for future projects and how it will be used in the community.
Let me answer the first question, and then Andy, you can answer the other ones. But the first question on getting taken seriously by the city council, right now we don't have an adopted creek and watershed management plan. So there's nothing for any future council to consider. But once it's adopted, then it's part of the city's planning process and policy process. So it's adopted and it needs to be effectuated. And that's how things get carried across from one council to another council and lives on in the future. So that adoption is a very important action on November 17th. So that's the first question.
Yeah, and I would just, in terms of kind of, you know, how this will get utilized in the future. As I mentioned, we'll have kind of these status reports where staff will present to the council. And that would give them an opportunity to flag the things they would like to see done, but it also provides an opportunity for the public. For those who are happy with how implementation is going or want to see certain things done, it gives them an opportunity to speak directly to the council on that implementation progress. So that dialogue can continue as we move forward and track the implementation over time. So I think that'll be a really important thing. And then also there'll be updates every 5 to 10 years to the plan itself to make sure it's current and that you know, the implementation program makes sense for the city. So there are those kind of those intermediate touch points and those kind of longer term touch points that I think will be really valuable. And it will also, because there's specific outreach called for, the public will be we'll have more opportunities to be informed about what's going on and can then kind of, you know, act accordingly and advocate for certain things as in the future.
Okay, the next question is from Brian Troutline. And just 1 second.
I think it just moved to answer, did it?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I just answered it.
Okay.
So we'll maybe go to, okay, so the next one, Paul, it wasn't a question, maybe go to Scott's.
Okay. Scott Cooper, could you address the current budget constraints to the city and how that would affect any implementation of the CWMP?
Yeah, so I'll start and other city staff may want to also chime in. Well, currently, you know, we tightened our budget for fiscal year 2021, which started July 1st. in response to COVID and kind of the uncertainty with, you know, the funding sources to the city. And so there's nothing in that budget in particular for CWMP implementation because we don't have an adopted plan. Moving forward, you know, I can't speak to exactly what, you know, the next budget will be, but there certainly the concerns about the economy will weigh on what the budget will look like. There's already kind of constraints on staffing at City Hall based on, you know, not hiring vacant positions currently. So there are these questions that will need to get addressed, and kind of those limitations will likely continue for in the short term. There's also, in terms of capital projects, you know, when the capital improvement program is discussed, there's already a lot of projects in that program, projects that have not been completed. So if the CWMP adds new projects over time, or, you know, these projects that are flagged in the CWMP get developed into capital projects, something's going to have to give with the capital improvement program budget and staffing. So there's those limitations that are just, you know, real. We don't have any city staff that are kind of just waiting to implement. So those are things we'll have to wrestle with, certainly in the short term. You know, middle term and long term, there may be more options available to us. And I don't know if any city staff wants to add to that. All right, it looks like not, but so those will be things we'll be thinking about, you know, kind of in the near future, is kind of the juggling of priorities and questions about funding.
Okay, the next question comes from Carl Ryder and Tecla
Lotito.
I'm sorry for butchering the name there. Is that part of the Glen Annie Creek watershed?
Yes. So Tecla Tito, we just considered that full creek to be Glen Annie, but many know at least the southern portion, kind of south of 101, south of Hollister, maybe the whole creek as Tecla Tito. We just refer to it as Glen Annie, but it's one and the same in terms of how we considered that. Yes.
And the next question is from Ruth. In relation to bird surveys, can the UCSB Audubon, Goleta Coast Audubon, and Santa Barbara Audubon be involved with these going forward?
And I would probably defer that to George or whoever will be doing, you know, future survey work. We did have a member of representing Audubon on our technical advisory committee. So we did have that engagement with Audubon. We're certainly happy to engage with Audubon moving forward as well. But I think it'll depend on kind of, you know, how we do those, any surveys in the future. We didn't specifically call out bird surveys as an implementation action, but, you know, I think we'd have to consider how that would work in the future. And I don't know if George has any thoughts on that. Otherwise, it's something we just have to look at in the future.
Yeah, it sounds like there's members that are willing to participate and volunteer and get involved, which is great news.
And I will note, like, we've talked with Audubon about sharing, you know, our survey results with them so that they can kind of document it and add it to their kind of resource database. So we'll be doing that for sure.
And Michael is asking, he said, maybe I missed it, but where to post questions? Can I submit a verbal questions?
Yeah, we'll get through, hi Michael, we'll get through the written questions, and then we'll, I see your hand raised. So we'll take, you're all set up for that once we get through these written questions.
And I see that John would like to answer the question live.
Okay.
And then Brian also, he thanked John, but he said table 5 does not list Black Cottonwood Forest as ESHA. Is this an omission? Other sensitive communities are called ESHA in table 5.
And I don't know if John or Melissa wants to respond.
I can start answering while they're whatever. It's going to be ESHA if it meets the definition of ESHA. For example, if it's riparian habitat in a creek, it's automatically going to be ESHA. And so if it's not listed out in Table 5, which I don't have in front of me right now, maybe John's looking for it, then that's a different situation. But by default, it's an ESHA by definition. And we'll take a look at that table. Oh, go ahead, Melissa.
No, yeah, I just wanted to thank Brian for his comment. It appears that was probably a typo. We'll look into it and correct. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, Brian.
All right. And then, so I think that gets us to the end.
Yes.
Yeah, Eddie, I'm not sure.
Oh, Eddie,
I'm not sure what you're referencing. Pam, if you want to maybe summarize, or I'll just go over quickly the answered questions. Paul mentioned deer and cathedral oaks, and John responded that, you know, they use them for food, water, and shelter, but they're not deer are not common within the city. And again, you can look at the appendices and see kind of what wildlife we did document within the creeks. So that gives kind of a tabular information that is pretty helpful. And then Brian had a question about black cottonwood, and John responded, but we'll look at the black cottonwood question on that table in section 4. And then Brian asked how many members of the public. We're up to 15, so 15 members of the public are in attendance currently. And certainly, if I hadn't mentioned this already, we are recording this session, so we'll be posting it on the website soon, we hope, hopefully by tomorrow, if not in the next couple of days. So if you know of anyone who may be interested but wasn't able to attend, you can direct them to the project site where we'll have that posted. And then Paul had a question that John responded to regarding groundwater. This is certainly something we heard a lot about from the public and the TAC members, and we included a lot of consideration for base flow issues, including all of Program 15 that includes several actions to consider the groundwater issue. Base flows, which include questions about depletion of groundwater and how the groundwater system interacts with the creek flow itself. So we did include consideration of that. So I think that covers the written question. So we'll now open it up to the participants to raise your hands if you would like to verbally ask us questions or make any comments. Katie Chalfant from RRM is gonna help us out, and we'll unmute individuals one by one, and you can have an opportunity to speak to us, and we'll go from there.
And Andy, I think that because we are recording this, we'll go back through and all the written questions we'll formally type out responses that will be available as part of for people to review later.
Awesome. We'll start with Michael here. I'll click allow to talk. And you should be good to talk now, Michael.
We need to unmute him. Michael, are you there? Hey, Katie, it shows up that he's muted. Do we need to unmute him?
Hi, Andy. I think I'm good now.
Yeah.
Okay. Hi, Michael.
Yeah, first of all, I just wanted to say thanks. I really appreciate the city taking the time and money to develop this plan. I think it's a really good starting point. And I just want to acknowledge that. The other point that I wanted to bring up is I know there's been some concern raised at City Council and with some members of the public as to whether this plan recommends creek designated creek buffers for future development. I think one of the biggest disappointments in a lot of developments in Goleta have been an inconsistent implementation of creek buffers. Does this plan include recommendations on creek buffers?
So thanks for the question, Michael. It does not include a specific recommendation to any changes to CE 2.2. There is an action that calls for future consideration of a CE 2.2 policy amendment. I will note though that we're also in the process of working to get a certified local coastal program. And one of the questions with that project will be ESHA buffers generally, and specifically the creek buffer. We also have some added some teeth to that, the buffer reduction question in Title 17, the zoning ordinance. And there's really some specific findings that you'd need to make to get a reduction, more specific and detailed than what was historically applied, because we didn't have the implementing regulations for CE 2.2. And one of the things we hope the CWMP can provide also is information when considering either a change to the policy or any reduction to the policy, including, you know, the information about like how the wildlife use the corridor. So we're not just thinking about kind of the plant species or the biology within the creek itself, but also kind of broader how that, the values of that creek. But there is no, to answer directly, there is no specific recommendation in the CWMP.
Okay, great. I can just say I would request that something of about creek buffers and your recommendations be included. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Michael.
All right, we'll pass it off to Brian.
Good evening. I'm Brian Troutwine. I'm an environmental analyst and watershed program coordinator for the Environmental Defense Center. I'm also a member of the city appointed technical advisory committee for the Creek and Watershed Management Plan and a 50-year Goleta resident. And I wanted to make a brief statement on behalf of the EDC tonight. First, I wanted to thank the staff and the consultants. We really appreciate their work on this plan, as well as the public who participated. And we're very grateful to the city for prioritizing this plan. EDC's comments tonight are not so much about the specifics in the plan. Our comments are intended to be more bigger picture and higher level, getting at how to implement the plan. It's a good plan. We want to make sure that the community's investment in terms of the dollars spent, the staff and public time and expertise really pays off with on the ground watershed improvements and public benefits. To that end, we think the Creek and Watershed Management Plan should be developed into a city program with city staff under perhaps the Parks and Open Space Division and Public Works as recommended in the Creek and Watershed Management Plan or in another department as appropriate. This will ensure that the plan is not just another plan that, you know, sits on our desks, but it's actually something that's implemented and provides the intended public benefits. To that end, EDC recommends that the city create and appoint a public city and watershed management advisory committee to guide the program and to vet priorities and projects, much like the city of Santa Barbara has for their city creeks program. The advisory committee would ideally include conservation representatives, neighborhood representatives from different watersheds, maybe a business representative or two, to ensure that the funding is spent properly to benefit the public by enhancing our watersheds. We envision the stormwater management plan and staff being housed in the future Creek and Watershed Management Program. EDC also recommends that the city adopt the Creek and Watershed Management Plan as a new element in the city's general plan to institutionalize the plan within the city's structure. One model we may want to look to is San Luis Obispo Creek, where they actually turned the shops around to face the creek, providing more foot traffic and trails, including dining patios overlooking the creek and events to ensure economic benefits as part of the plan and to bring in businesses and business groups to create a true win-win for our community. So we foresee creek restoration and habitat benefits, water quality improvement, recreation, and economic benefits from implementation of the city's future creek and watershed management program. Funding, of course, will be necessary to achieve the intended public benefits. And we know the city of Santa Barbara increased its transient occupancy tax or hotel bed tax in 2000, but that may not be the best option for Goleta. Other options have been talked about, including redirecting revenue neutrality agreement dollars back into the city to fund watershed programs that benefit both the city and the county, since the watersheds cover both the city and the county. The idea of a sales tax has been discussed to provide funding to implement the creek and watershed management program, as well as a bond measure that could be placed on the ballot in the future to let the voters decide how and whether to fund the creek and watershed management program. And we actually have time to think these things through carefully because of COVID. The pandemic allows us time to determine where to specifically house the program, in which city agency or department or division, and how to fund it. When we get through this pandemic and revenues are back up, the city and its partners should be prepared to pursue funding for a citywide creek and watershed management program. And to that end, EDC intends to ask the City Council on November 17th to set up a task force to study options for funding and to study where to house the program within the city structure. Then, as part of the post-COVID recovery, the task force could bring these options back to the City Council to consider exactly how to fund the program, how to implement it, and where to house the program within which city department. And again, we just wanted to thank the city staff, the city council, the consultants, and the whole team and members of the public for their great work on this plan. Thank you.
Thanks, Brian. We don't have any other hands up right now, so feel free to raise your hand if you'd like to ask us anything or provide any comments. I'll note, as we wait, we had a couple more question and answer submissions, one from Ruth. Thanking us for a very informational meeting. And then Eddie Harris provided a comment about improved groundwater infiltration and retrofitting of neighborhoods. I won't read the whole comment, but we flagged the stormwater regulations. Now this applies to new development, but they're really important and there's much more of a focus on retention of stormwater, rainwater on site, and that will improve infiltration. That's one of the main benefits. There's also a few potential capital projects in city parks to improve groundwater infiltration. And then we also have flagged kind of future pilot projects for hydro modification improvements. So that again is looking at kind of green infrastructure, that type of thing. With that said, there are challenges of proactively forcing improvements on private property. We can't just go and force someone to do something if they're not asking something from us, like in terms of development. So there is that constraint on the built environment. One of the ideas with like pilot projects or trying to show the benefits is to maybe bridging that gap to get to other projects on private property. But that's pretty challenging because there's going to be a cost associated with that. Where if the private property owner isn't seeking to do anything and isn't forced to do that, it would just be a cost with no kind of financial return for them. So that's a challenge of kind of retrofitting on private property in particular, but something we'll try to address. And there are some actions in the CWMP that consider that. And then Scott just added a comment saying good presentation and plan. So thank you, Scott. Are there any other attendees that want to speak or want to, if you have any last burning questions you want to type in, please do so now. Give you a couple minute here.
It looks like we had one more comment too.
So this is a question from Carl about habitat management plan on a wetland and upland restoration adjacent to Tecolotito as part of VLC. So oftentimes we have, you know, restoration or improvement plans that are part of approvals for development. I don't know, I might see if Anne can recall any offhand for development, but it's not uncommon for there to be restoration plans for both capital projects and private development. And then there'll be certain performance measures that need to be met for those restoration projects. And I don't know, do you have any other examples offhand?
There's a restoration plan for the hideaways, for example, for the bluffs development. I think for many of these larger developments that are along a creek, there's a restoration plan, and then they implement the plan, and then it goes into long-term maintenance. Yeah, there's one for the Willow Creek townhomes in Old Town, on Old San Jose Creek. So yeah, there's quite a few, but they're connected in with the development. And so having, with whatever the development approval is, but having a creek and watershed management plan adopted will help get some kind of uniform treatment with these various development projects, because they'll be able to use the policy in the creek and watershed management plan, and the approving body will be able to refer to the creek and watershed management plan, which I think probably ties into what EDC was saying about having an element of policy in the general plan would even lock that in even more, which is, you know, probably why Brian Troutwine mentioned that. But either way, the an adopted plan is going to get picked up more so if it was in the general plan, but certainly an adopted creek and watershed management plan would really help all of these management restoration plans.
And also note that Scott mentioned, and Scott Cooper was the Audubon representative on our TAC, he commented that Audubon endorses Brian's suggestions for future steps as well. So just wanted to note that. Any other last comments or anyone else wishing to speak? All right, seeing none, I will say that this is not your last opportunity. As we've already mentioned, we'll take this to council on November 17th. So there'll be an opportunity to submit comment and to comment at that meeting. That's an evening meeting that starts at 5:30, and the agenda for that will come out before that meeting, of course, so you can see where we'll be on the agenda. But if you want to provide any comments or discuss the CWMP with city staff, please email cwmp@cityofgaleta.org. We'll get back to you right away, and we're happy to talk to any of you or any of your colleagues or other interested folks that weren't able to attend. We're always willing and excited to discuss this project with anyone who would like to discuss it. So don't hesitate in reaching out to us. With that, I wanna thank everyone for attending. I know it's a busy week. There's a lot going on locally and in this country. So I wanna thank you all for taking the time for joining us tonight. So thank you.